Okay, so October 3rd is a very important day for Germany because officially Germany became unified, united again in 1990 on October 3rd. So I chose to present the architecture of this very important city in Europe by the way of this event, which is without doubt a very important one in the life and culture of Germany. I will begin rather capriciously with an architect who didn't build much, but who is well known, that is John Haydock, a North American architect who built a few things in Berlin in the 80s when he was invited together with other many important architects of the 80s to build some housing. And John Haydock was the dean of Cooper Union in New York, a very important architecture school. And he was one of the New York Five, the other four being Richard Meyer, Peter Eisenman, Wadmin Siegel, and Michael Graves. So I'll show first the Kreuzberger Tower. Well, he actually built not just this tower, but also the two, less tall buildings on the left and the right. They could be seen as somehow strange. In fact, they were almost demolished, but the community of architects in Berlin and in Germany and maybe even beyond Germany protested, so the buildings were saved. His architecture is, his built architecture is, in my opinion, perhaps a little bit less important than his graphic work. And his books on architecture show a very different attitude towards architecture. And the books are very, very nice. And theoretically, so to speak, his work, and poetically, I would say, and poetically, I think his work is important. But this architecture is a little bit stiff, even although it has surreal elements. it has some strange rigidity somehow. It is an architecture that, in my opinion, is approximating somehow that of models. So buildings look like models almost. This is my opinion. Maybe other people think in a different way. we'll see also something else built by John Haydock in Berlin. I will not insist a lot because we have more than 400 pictures with a lot of architecture from Berlin, and I would like to cover all of it today when, as I said, on October 3rd, 1990, Germany became unified again. And as I mentioned before in a private discussion with someone who is here, Berlin had the wisdom to invite very important architects to build three times during the during the 20th century. And this is, they created colonies of blocks of flats and, housing units during three times in the 20th century, once in the 30s, once in the 50s, and once in the 80s. So they have now a great constellation of important buildings built by important architects during these three periods of time that I mentioned. So these are John Haydock. He was the professor of Daniel Lipskind. In fact, the Jewish Museum is not far away from this, these three buildings by John Haydock. So you can see almost the work of the former student from here and vice versa. You can see these three works from the museum. So, you know, the two Americans, if I can include Daniel Lipskind in under this naming, American, he was, but he was born in Poland. Anyway, so John Haydock in Berlin, he built this in the 80s. And I suggest you search for his work on the web, because he had a very particular vision about architecture, expressed through countless drawings and even poems. Now, a house for two brothers, which he built also in Berlin. Actually, it's a strange house in a way, with a very, very, very strange, I would consider, plan. And I hope I have here the plan of the building. It's called a house for two brothers. They appear to be two houses. They are connected where the tall element is there, but you know, they are distinctively, you know, expressing themselves as two separate houses. I mean, from that elevation, from this one, it appears to be a single house. But look at the plan. The plan, in my opinion, is maddening. I mean, you know, look at the multitude of doors and the narrowness of spaces, actually. You know, how many doors are here? I'm tempted to think that this is the building with the largest number of doors, considering the, you know, the general area, which is not so big. It's like, you know, 16 meters by 16 meters. But you have there, you know, I don't know, maybe more than 50, 60 doors. Yeah, strange plan, in my opinion. Perfectly symmetrical. And with something neurotical about it, I would say. Although the geometry is very strict. Very controlling, I feel tempted to say, somehow. It's a plan which seems to advocate control, not so much freedom. Anyway, this is the model, A House for Two Brothers by John Haydock in Berlin. Now, the Berlin mask, he even published a beautiful book. These are sketches from that series, The Berlin Mask. I don't know exactly what he referred to, in what way, you know, he brought in the word mask. You see, it was from 1981. This is John Haydock. He drew speculative architecture. He drew very, very well, and poetically somehow. I invite to further study of this rather unique architect. So, surrealism architecture, the architectural uncanny, Berlin mask architecture, urbanism. There are all kinds of issues that he addressed through his studies. Now, Zvi Hacker, a very interesting architect who was also born in Poland, like Daniel Lipskind, but as opposed to Daniel Lipskind, who went to the United States, Zvi Hacker went to Israel, and he built some remarkable buildings in Israel. But now you are going to see a building he built in Berlin, a school, the Heinz Galinsky Schule school. It's quite spectacular, seen from above, as you can see, a very, you know, dynamic, tormented and tormenting school. It's not so tormented and so tormenting from the level of the eye, but from above, it certainly is. And just like in the case of John Haydock, I invite further study at Zvi Hacker. You can find all his works on the web. I think he's still alive. This is the school seen from the level of the eye. Probably, you know, I don't know the requirements of the program. Maybe a certain visceralization of the building was not, further visceralization of the building was not desired. I don't know, because, you know, from this, you wouldn't really expect this. There is much more drama from seen from the top than from the level of the eye. Anyway, this is the architect in his office in Israel. Very different architect from Daniel Ipskind, less extroverted, I would say, less interested in publicity, less involved in politics. I like Zvi Hecker, and I think he was and is a very important architect. These are studies by Zvi Hecker for this school that he built in Berlin. Good architecture cannot be legal. It is illegal. That's what he wrote. And I feel tempted to say, yes, he's right. And his amusing way, I think, is correct. Good architecture cannot be legal. It is legal, illegal. And it is to be illegal in the sense that, you know, good architecture is concerned with something that transcends, you know, restrictions, transcends bureaucracy, transcends the smallness of small concerns, and its aim is something else. So the students and the architect should pay attention to Zvi Hecker. Good architecture is illegal, and it should be illegal, I would add. Anyway, because those architects who you know, defend the mediocrity of their works because the rules or the laws were you know, against them and they had to conform, this is nonsense. If you are a good architect, you fight for your ideas, and you know, you serve the high-end gods of architecture and not the high-end gods of bureaucracy or politics or even money. Anyway, this is what I believe, and this is what Zvi Hecker believes, and I'm happy I do not think differently from him. So this is the school in Berlin by an architect who is not as well known as he deserves, in my opinion. This is a book, Architects and Master Builders in Berlin. As you can see, he's there. And this drawing is his, also his, the same building, the school. I wish there was more, you know, the materials were less, you know, less quiet in a way. That's why I use the word visceralization. But in other works, he proved his ability to do that. But maybe here in Berlin, he couldn't do it. I don't know. Anyway, it's still probably an interesting building to explore and to have your kids study. Now, Daniel Ipskind, also born in Poland, but as I mentioned, he didn't go to Israel like Zvi Hecker. He went to the United States and he studied at Cooper Union in New York, where his dean or the dean of the school was John Haydack, the first architect I started with this presentation. The Jewish Museum, which we all know, this zigzagging building, protesting an unfair history. And this is the old building. And this is what Daniel Ipskind built. He also built the covering of this, previously probably was a courtyard. Now it is covered and enclosed, and he did this as well. So this is the work of Daniel Ipskind and the museum also, the zigzagging museum. You see, these architects that I'm showing prove that it is worth taking risks in architecture. These people took risks. They didn't work, you know, you know, on some expected way. They propose something new. And it's indeed, if you don't risk, in my opinion, you cannot arrive at a high level of accomplishment. It's also true that when you risk, you could fail. But as somebody said, if you risk, you could fail. But if you don't risk, you fail for sure. Anyway, some images from inside the museum, the well-known diagonals of Daniel Lipskind, which appear both on the elevation of the building, elevations of the building, and inside the building through the lighting and so on. This was not, it's not a museum to promote, you know, a happy-go-lucky, you know, atmosphere. It's about tragic events and is about suffering, and thus it has a certain so-called darkness. He is actually having his office in Berlin, and as you know, he builds a lot. He built another building in Berlin. I don't know if I have it in this presentation. I hope I do. Anyway, this is the Jewish Museum by Daniel Lipskind. He actually became well known after he won a competition in Berlin as well with a housing complex. I don't know if I have that project here. I wish I do, but let's see. Now, the rationalist and the functionalist would protest these windows, would say, wait a minute, you know, what is this? This is nonsense. But, you know, architecture is not about what the rationalist and the functionalist say. It's more. Here is the architect, a master of public relations as well. This is the you know, surrounded by this space that he covered and with those tormented columns or vertical supports, or not so vertical. Well, they are vertical, but not as expected within the old building. But you can tell that is the same author, the same architect. The memory void, you know, he, because this museum was supposed to send a message of beware, be aware, be do not allow, you know, tragic events to happen as they did happen. So I think he succeeded. And again, it's an unusual museum because it's not meant to, you know, for laughter or joy or you know, placid contemplation. It's meant to provoke a reaction and to you know, stir you up. So tragedies will not happen again. Although, you know, it seems human beings, as Rem Koolhaas himself said, do not learn. And this seems to be the case, unfortunately. So again, this is the museum, and this is also the work of Daniel Lipskind here. Paul Celan Court. Paul Celan or Paul Celan? Paul Celan, I would say, because he lived for a good number of years in France, was actually born in Romania. And he was considered very, very highly in the field of poetry. In fact, so highly that he was placed in the vicinity of Goethe and Hölderlin in German poetry. Although he suffered tremendously during the Second World War when he lost his family in concentration camps and so on. And he committed suicide at 50 in Paris. But he is a poet, one of the most important poets of the 20th century. And Daniel Lipskind built, it's a court, it's an open space, it's here, which is called the Paul Celan, you know, court. inside the museum. This is important to know. And for Romanians, this is also important to know that this was a poet born in Romania. And rest here as well. Okay, moving forward, we have a lot to see tonight about Berlin. And Berlin did have and does have a lot to offer in the field of architecture, and not only in the field of architecture. Frank Gehry, another American, as you know, the DZ Bank, which is across the street from the Holocaust Memorial by Peter Eisenman. This is, in my opinion, one of the better or best, one of the best buildings by Frank Gehry, particularly this, the interior here where the courtyard is and that, Baroque architecture, if I can call it so. Maybe you know that Frank Gehry was inspired by Bernini, you would say these did be constructivists. They are not connected with history. Well, it's not so at all. Peter Eisenman was a great admirer of Palladio. I myself attended 5 lectures by Peter Eisenman on Palladio at Cooper Union, in fact, in New York many years ago. And now he's at 88, he will be 89. He is very preoccupied, or I think he is already 89. His birthday was 2 months ago or so. He's studying Alberti, approaching 90. Bravo to him. And Frank Gehry, inspired by Bernini. And Lipskind also is a very well-read man and very aware of history and so on. So let's not imagine the deconstructivists, because all 3 of them were part of the exhibition Deconstructivism in New York in the early 90s. Do not imagine that the deconstructivists do not know the history of architecture. They know it very well, but they transcend it in the sense that, you know, you cannot move forward in any field unless you bring something new. You have to bring something new, otherwise you'll remain in the fog of anonymity. This is also a tower proposed by Frank Gehry, but it was not built. Also for Berlin. Back to the DZ Bank, which is right across the street from the Holocaust Memorial. In fact, this facade is facing across the street the Holocaust Memorial by Peter Eisenman, another very important work in the architecture of Berlin. And maybe this facade of the building by Frank Gehry is because of the urban context, the urban fabric and so on. It's still Frank Gehry, but it's a little more ordered, disciplined in a way. And this might be, in this case, a plus. So Frank Gehry, a bank in Berlin. And you can see the building by Gehry from the Holocaust Memorial by Peter Eisenman. Peter Eisenman, we just talked of him. Here it is, the Holocaust Memorial. Courageous work right in the heart of a courageous and troubled major city, Berlin. Maybe you know Peter Eisenman thought and advocated that you must begin any work with a grid. And that's how he began here, but then he began to sabotage the grid. And this is the result for this memorial of the Holocaust. You are probably not supposed to step on these, you know, or to sit on them, but people, you know, take the freedom to do so. Anyway, let's hope that these constructions, these buildings, that Berlin, I would say, generously hosts now, should make a future war less possible, because it's really about this. This is a way of attempting to diminish the tragedies that the world is confronted with from time to time. The architecture is innovative, of course, and look at it, you know. I mean, what city in the world or what architect or architects would conceive and build something like this, you know? It shows the sophistication of the culture in Berlin, that you know, they understood that you know, architecture cannot remain placidly anchored in the déjà vu of history. There is also this part underground. It's complex, this work, and it's something between some kind of landscape architecture. It's a memorial which does not scream at you, "Look at me, I'm a memorial." It is both assertive and reticent somehow. It's a memorial for the murdered Jews in Berlin, and what can we say? Let's hope that the things of this nature will not happen again. The Checkpoint Charlie Museum also was designed by Peter Eisenman at Checkpoint Charlie. This is not, I would say, a really major work of architecture, but anyway, he built it. The Checkpoint Charlie is right here, this intersection, and across the, you know, this intersection or these streets is a building by Rem Koolhaas. But this one is by Peter Eisenman, what you see here. The Peter Eisenman, who at one point at least was very interested in so-called weak architecture, but his name in translation from German is the Iron Man. So there. Talking about you know, contradictions or oxymoronic things. This is a tower for Max Reinhardt that he proposed, and I like this. I like this project. It was not, it's true, connected with the urban context at all. It stood out. There were only low level buildings around it, but the tower itself, I like. I confess, I would rather say I admire. It's contorted, but the geometry, I mean, it is a building, it is a project that uses reason, but then it sabotages it, and anyway, it was not built. But I think it would have been nice if it was built, although it was probably meant to be. I don't know if it was meant. It could have been a threatening building, but isn't art threatening in its very essence? Because through art, I mean, I know, you know, one would say, no, excuse me, it's not so, it's not threatening. But the otherness of art could at times be threatening, because, you know, it's about épater la bourgeoisie, shocking the bourgeois, and escaping the predictability of a life, of an ordinary life. So in that sense, it is threatening. Art is challenging us. And if and when it is not challenging us, I think it fails. Because major art always brings something new, stirs us up. Imagine the paintings of Vincent van Gogh when he made them, and when he was never able to sell except once for the equivalent of $5. And now a painting by Vincent van Gogh sells for more than 100 million. So you see, this building was not built, but if it was built, I think it would have been, even a threatening presence in the urban landscape in Berlin. I don't think this building would have been, would have left too many people indifferent, but it was not built. Anyway, does it testify about the otherness of art? Well, I think it does, even if by otherness, in this case, we don't mean necessarily something very soothing indeed. Anyway, another work by Peter Reisemann, which was not built. For the German director Max Reinhardt, a very important theater and film director, Jean Nouvel, of course, he had to be there too, because again, Berlin had the wisdom to invite important architects to build in their city, to build there. And bravo to them, bravo to Berlin. The gallery is Lafayette. It's a commercial building, but being a Jean Nouvel building, it had to have something interesting too. I would say that here is also a subtle clin d'oeil, if I am to use a French expression, towards the past. And I see here some reference to Mendelssohn, an important German architect. Again, this architect at this level, at this stature of accomplishments, they know things, they know the history of architecture, and they do pay homage when they feel like it is almost required to do so. There are two pyramids inside, conical pyramids, two voids actually, conical, within the building. And I hope I have a section here, one pointing downwards, one pointing upwards. This is the one pointing downwards, and above is the one pointing upwards. So Jean Nouvel, Le Galerie Lafayette, here it is. You can see the two opposing cones, one smaller, one larger, within the structure of the building. Jean Nouvel. Norman Foster, of course, Sir Norman Foster, excuse me. He had to be here too, with his well-known dome above the Reichstag, all glass. I don't know, here I might have some maybe peculiar thoughts. I somehow compare it to the glass pyramid by I.M. Pei at the Louvre. This is in Berlin at the Reichstag. I'm not so sure that a pyramid is supposed to be made of glass and that a dome is supposed to be made of glass. But I understand that in this case, it was meant in a way to be counter to the image, the grave, heavy meaning associated with the Reichstag, and bring some luminous democratic atmosphere at the top of the building, perhaps. Anyway, it was built. You see the building, which was which had a history not with the lightest meanings associated to it. And then the dome of Sir Norman Foster at the top, which you can enter, you can visit, it is what it is. I personally prefer the dome over Santa Maria del Fiore by Brunelleschi in Florence, but it was a different time. Anyway, Sir Norman Foster, without doubt, knows how to accomplish things, and he was perhaps the right architect for this job. Maybe Richard Rogers, also Sir Richard Rogers, he also built here. So truly the Rhine, Berlin, so many buildings by so many important architects. And in this presentation, I'll show many of the works. The Daimler Chrysler building, this company is producing, well, at that time it was called like this, but they were making the well-known luxury car Mercedes. And this is the building, or the complex of buildings by Sir Richard Rogers. Here, you know, barely seen, it can be observed a building built by his former partner, Renzo Piano, who also built several buildings here. But here is Sir Richard Rogers from London, from Great Britain. It is moving to see that a city try to renew itself by, you know, an international effort coming from important architects. And I think they chose correctly. So this is Sir Richard Rogers. Even Arata Isozaki built here, and others. Renzo Piano, I just mentioned him. He used to, they together with Sir Richard Rogers, they won the Centre Beaubourg competition, and they built it in Paris. This is a skyscraper on Potsdamer Platz Square. It's not really a skyscraper. The Daimler Financial Services in Potsdamer Platz. He built all these buildings. I think even this one on the right is by Renzo Piano. I like this building by Piano. There is a ceramic tile that is used here with this color. He worked together with a German architect, and I think they did a good job. It's an architecture that is, you know, it has dignity, it has order, and the warmth of the ceramic tile, I think, adds something to these buildings. Another building by him here. We saw, in fact, a picture or two of this building previously. This is how it is called, the Bishaus building in the Daimler Square. I like these buildings more than some other buildings by Renzo Piano. Potsdamer Platz, I'm not sure, again, if this was done by Renzo Piano, it might have been, but I am not sure. But these were certainly by Renzo Piano. Mies van der Rohe, of course, he was German and he had to come back to Berlin. And this building is a famous work by Mies van der Rohe, the National Art Gallery, the new art gallery, and you know, a typical Mies van der Rohe. The elegance of the structure is obvious. This huge, you know, covering of the building, this huge roof is supported just by, you know, eight points. Slender, well, approximately slender. It's a good building, I think. And just a second, sorry. There is also close by a building by James Stirling. I don't know if I have it here, from his postmodern part of his activity, not the most glorious in my opinion, but the building by Mies is in my opinion is one of his best works. And you can see the structure is here, 1, 2, 3, 4, and then other four on the other side, and that's it. Now, the artworks are not by Mies, but that's okay, the building is. During construction, I think it was built in the 50s. Skyscraper project. This was a project, in my opinion, an important work by Mies, although it was not built. And the rendering which he did, in my opinion, is brilliant. It was done manually, of course, and shows the expressionism of the early Mies. Two views of the same project. Again, it was not built, but it was proposed for Berlin. This was the plan of the building. So he didn't always work rectangularity. He even used curves, and there is another. I hope I have it here. Another project where you can see that at the beginning, at least, he was less strict about his architectural language. Now James Stirling. It seems I don't have the other project by Mies here, which was also not built. James Stirling, whom I mentioned, the British Embassy in Berlin, this is another building built by James Stirling, an important British architect. Sorry about the Alami word, which appears in a bothering way on this photograph, but that's how they claim authorship, by destroying their own pictures, which often are good. But the proof of authorship is so strident that it irritates me every time I come across a picture by them. This is the other building that I mentioned by James Stirling, which in my opinion is a little bit too affected by what we call postmodernism. Now, Aldo Rossi, another important European architect who unfortunately died tragically in a car accident. He built a lot of blocks of flats in Berlin. And this is, a whole block, with buildings. This is another one also by Aldo Rossi, unafraid to also use color, color that is not necessarily the least noticeable. It's fine. So again, Berlin, a city with a great personality, did not reject the idea to invite other kinds of personalities from other architects in the city. And it got richer because of this, in my opinion. And now they have indeed, as I called it, a constellation of interesting buildings by many interesting architects. So here is Aldo Rossi. Here is a portrait of him, sketched as it is. So this presentation tonight is really some kind of an ad memoir, is a review of a large body of work by many people. Aldo Rossi again, a courtyard in one of these complexes of apartment buildings. Aldo Rossi, sorry for the resolution of the plan, but you see here the courtyard that was photographed here. Rossi again. It's hard not to recognize him, actually. The typical, you know, sketches by Aldo Rossi he drew incessantly. Carl Friedrich Schinkel, a very important 19th century architect in Germany, and we'll see a few buildings by him in Berlin. I don't know very well how to pronounce this because I don't know German and I apologize. It's a temple in a way like a structure that was appropriated for other functions, even by the Nazis. Anyway, it's a small building, but a moving building, particularly because of its interior. So again, we are dealing with a 19th century architect who was pendulating rather precariously between Romanticism and Classicism. And Schinkel was indeed a major force in the architecture of Germany of 19th century. And in Berlin, inside post-reunification, Neue Wache, showing the Cathe Kollwitz sculpture, Mother with her dead son, and the oculus, which exposes it to the elements. So here it is, the sculpture of an important artist, female artist, and the oculus. And this, so this is the interior of this building by Carl Friedrich Schinkel. Mother with a dead son. What could be more said? An architecture for Prussia. And this building is also in Berlin, built by Schinkel. Now these are photographs from the unfortunate time when the Nazis took the power, and we know what followed. This is what happens when the military is taking control of everything. Yes, Berlin was a very troubled city, but it continues to be a very important city. And, you know, we expect from Berlin gestures in the field of culture that are not insignificant. The Altes Museum in Berlin from 1830, also by Schinkel, a very important building, one of the most important buildings in Berlin, a very powerful building, which again seems to conciliate somehow between Classicism and Romanticism. This is a rendering by Schinkel, who was also a painter. Now, even if some people might not like columns any longer, you know, in this case, as in other cases where good architecture is contemplated. The columns do have power, and they do have even poetry, if I am to refer to architectural poetry. The interior is modeled by the example coming down to the time when this was built from the Pantheon in Rome. A rendering, yes, a line drawing by Schinkel, I think. We are talking, of course, about one of the important cities of the world. And, we should be grateful that it was not, totally ravaged by war. Look at those columns there. They are, appreciable in size. If you consider the human silhouette. Now, Bruno Taut, also a very important German architect. He built several apartment buildings. These are just some of his buildings in Berlin. He also built that very important glass pavilion at the exhibition in Köln in 1914, but unfortunately it was destroyed. Anyway, even in the field of housing, I think he was relevant. And, this I like about German architects, that they do not neglect social issues. And many of them didn't, they even, architects with extravagant visions in architecture, like, Hans Scharoun, for example, they also built blocks of flats, and not for an elite, but for anybody, an architecture for all, if I am to use this expression. So these buildings were built by Bruno Taut, and he built others. So I'm going to show them, I hope, in this presentation. It's an architecture which has still an architectural interest, even if it's not so-called extravagant. Now, this one, the Horseshoe Estate, also built by Bruno Taut in Berlin in the 30s. So he built this, I guess the horseshoe brings good luck. Now, that is supposed to do so. So I imagine the people living here are auspiciously treated by fate. The architectural riches of the city are, almost astonishing. I mean, they have so much architecture that is of interest for the ones who love architecture. So, Bruno Taut. And you can see this building is very different from the other blocks of flats, not very tall, that we just saw. I don't know if he built this as well, but for sure he built this. What do all these architects tell us? I think they all tell us the same thing. Be creative, be innovative. Be poetical, be courageous, take risks, express yourself. Walter Gropius, the founder of the Bauhaus School, he participated in, as I said, there were three times in the history of the 20th century when Berlin invited important architects in the 30s, 50s, and 80s. He built this in 1957, block of flats. He returned from the States to do so. In the same campus, so to speak, there are other very important architects like Oscar Niemeyer, Alvar Aalto, Bakema, and so on. It's just amazing how this city was welcoming truly who's who in the architecture of that time. Now this one, the Siemensstadt, it was built between 1929 and 1931. This is the other colony, as I called it, under the overall master plan of German architect Hans Scharoun. Seven proeminent Weimar era architects took part: Scharoun, Fred Forbath, Otto Barning, Walter Gropius, Paul Rudolf Henning, not Paul Rudolf, the American, and Hugo Hering. The nickname Ringsiedlung came from the association of these architects with the Ring Collective. The open spaces were designed by the German modernist landscape architect, the house name you see there. And here you see some buildings built by these people. I don't know who built this one, maybe Hans Scharoun or Hans Hartung. I have to see a map in order to be able to identify correctly. But it's interesting to judge. This one is by Hans Scharoun. They built several blocks of flats. And the whole colony is important as a whole, but it is a whole composed of individual buildings that do have something to say individually, so to speak. I hope I have here a map with this particular colony of buildings built in the 30s. The names are not shown there. Anyway, Hans Scharoun, I already mentioned him, the Philharmonica, the Philharmonic building in Berlin, the Philharmonia, a very important building in Berlin, a building which is maybe could be described under the title or the naming of lyrical functionalism, although has touches of expressionism. I never entered this building, but I was told the sound is exceptional. And the inside of the building is musical itself, architecturally speaking. It's a building which is truly significant for modern architecture. Both buildings were designed by Hans Scharoun that you see here. I hope I have images from the inside as well. Yeah, sorry, it's not very clear, but I think you get an idea about the fluidity of the spaces. And it was not a formal fluidity. It was rather, I don't know. I mean, it was not, so much a quest for, extravagant form, but the form was born from an inner function, if I can say so. So the level of reality of the building is higher than in most cases where so-called fluidity was searched for, neglecting the specificities of certain functions. What I like about this building inside is that you have the whole of the space. It's a whole, but it's a whole where there are islands of individuality, if I can call them so, You know, they, you can sit in various parts of this open space, large space, and have the feeling that you participate to the collectiveness of the space, but also you belong to a smaller realm which is integrated into the larger one. I don't know if I expressed well, but if you see the plan, well, the plan at the level of you know, the open spaces outside of the auditoriums is it could be associated with disorder if you want, but it's actually a very sophisticated and I imagine functionally very positive handling of this continuity of space that exists and the musicality of the space, which is also reflected within the room itself where the music is performed. Now Le Corbusier, as I said, he built one of his four Unité d'Habitation. He built the first one in Marseille, in the south of France, which in my opinion is the best one. But he built also in Berlin. Is this one is a little bit, I don't know. It is a Unité d'Habitation by Le Corbusier, but when I visited it with some students, we were told by someone who lives there that actually the project by Le Corbusier was a little bit modified to, you know, to match the requirements of the German, I don't know, codes or anyway, not all dimensions prescribed by Le Corbusier were respected. I imagine some of them were considered too minimal. And anyway, there were some changes to the project that Le Corbusier generated. But all in all, it's based on his ideas of a large building. In the one in Marseille, I think houses 2,000 people. I don't know how many people here, probably, you know, the numbers are not significantly less than those in Marsilia or Marseille. These are not expensive apartments, you know, they are not made for, you know, they are not like in the, you know, 1000 Miami tower built by Zaha Hadid, which was intended for an elite. No, these are modest apartments, but they are built and imagined by an architect who had social concerns, and they work. I visited one of them. I was in one of them, that person who told us that the building was not quite built as he, you know, projected it, invited us to see the. So I was there with two or three students. Here are the plans of these apartments, or some of them. But if you compare these plans to the plans of the house for two brothers by John Haydock, you see a significant difference. Anyway, so this is Le Corbusier in Berlin with his Unité d'Habitation. This is not part of those three colonies. It was built around that time, but out at the edge of the city. Of course, there was no room for this very large building within the, you know, closer to the center of the city. So it's at the edge of the city. Here it is. Okay, moving forward, Rue Intérieure, the interior street within the l'unité d'habitation, I don't know how to translate it now in English. Anyway, you understand. I understood also when I visited it that there were some, you know, there were some devices to receive milk and the newspaper, I guess, of milk, I'm sure. But now I don't see them here. But when I visited, I think I saw something like this, and the explanation was given that, you know, milk could have been delivered to the specific units who, which, you know, desire that. Now, Le Corbusier was not himself a stranger to publicity, and he provoked it often. And there, see that group of people, you know, in the 50s, you know, staring at his concrete artistic work. The section through this building. Okay, moving forward with a funny picture. It's where life tries to imitate art. Usually it is thought that art imitates life, but sometimes life imitates art. Like in this case, perhaps. Alvaro Siza, a very different architect from all the others that we saw. He built this beautiful, in my opinion, a beautiful building, which I call it Bonjour Tristesse, because it is written here. Somebody wrote, this was not done by Alvaro Siza, but somebody wrote here, and I wonder how, because it must have been difficult. Anyway, somebody wrote here Bonjour Tristesse, which is a title of a book by François Sagan. It's a low-key building, but still with a certain distortion that provokes what I call the poetry of the building. I think it's a good building by Alvaro Siza. I'm happy he built it. I also learned when I attended a conference by Alvaro Siza that he was very influenced by a poet, a great Portuguese poet, Fernando Pessoa. Yes, an architect can be, and I almost felt like saying should be inspired by poetry and by a poet. Fernando Pessoa. I learned of Fernando Pessoa from Alvaro Siza, and he was indeed a great Portuguese poet, Fernando Pessoa. And look at the plan of the building. It's a very nice plan. You know, it's not a strident building at all. It's and yet it has something that escapes you know, banality, and that's where the art of the good architect steps in. You transform into poetry something that you know, cannot easily be called poetical from the beginning, but this is the role of the architect, to create a building which transcends expectations, and you could say there are risks in the quest for poetry of betraying function and so on. Now, a good architect can honor the functions and yet transcend them somehow at the same time, because architecture is about emotions. It is about, you know, being, you know, buildings that can be used, but it's also about emotion. And if you don't have that emotion, if you don't create that emotion, at least the possibility of that emotion, you cannot expect your building to arrive at the status of architecture, even if written, I would hesitate to use a capital A. When you say architecture, this has certain implications. Not every building is architecture, far from it. I like this building. You know, it's in its reticent way, I think is a very good work by this very important Portuguese architect. So very different from the architects that we saw previously. And there you can read Bonjour Tristesse and some sketches by Alvaro Siza, themselves quite poetical, are they not, or lyrical. Rem Koolhaas. Rem Koolhaas also had to be present here, and he has, to my knowledge, he has three buildings now. Unfortunately, I do not show in this presentation the last one, but I show the Dutch embassy. As you can see, there is truly, I don't think the word is exaggerated, a constellation of very interesting buildings, and I don't think I show here the very interesting buildings that I discovered actually without searching for them of the Scandinavian or the Nordic embassies in Berlin, some excellent buildings. This is by Rem Koolhaas, the embassy of the Netherlands, the Dutch embassy. He just built a large building, a very interesting building itself for a publisher, a major publisher. But I don't have pictures in this presentation with that work. Anyway, this is Rem Koolhaas with the Dutch embassy in Berlin. Now, the Friedrichstrasse block designed by architects Oma and Rem Koolhaas in the 80s. In fact, it's across the street, a little bit diagonally from the apartment building, which is now housing a museum. I don't know if initially it was meant to be a museum, by Peter Eisenman. And this is the building by Koolhaas here, and somewhere on the right, crossing the street diagonally, is Peter Eisenman. So Rem Koolhaas again, with a very different building from the previous one that we saw. On the Friedrichstrasse, if you keep going to the left here, you arrive and turn left, you arrive at those three buildings by John Haydock, and then not far away is also the Jewish Museum by Daniel Lipskind. On Friedrichstrasse is also the building by Jean Ouvel, but in the opposite direction, the Lafayette galleries. The Eric Mendelssohn, where I think, you know, I just mentioned Jean Ouvel, and in my opinion, in a rather subtle way, Jean Ouvel paid homage to Eric Mendelssohn, the IGM building in Berlin. He built several buildings here. This one is a little bit difficult to read again, to see because of the Alami thing. Now this one, that's Mosse House, 1922, 1921, 1923. And you can see here that there is this curved corner, not very dissimilar from what Jean Nouvel did. Of course, Jean Nouvel much later is in the corner of these two streets. So Eric Mendelssohn, a very important German architect, who also was an excellent photographer. I have seen photographs of American, North American buildings taken by Eric Mendelssohn. Now the Kino Universum is a cinema also designed by Eric Mendelssohn in 1926. He's associated with Expressionism, Eric Mendelssohn. And he's the author of the famous Einstein Tower. Now, Peter Behrens, also a very important German architect, the AEG turbine factory from 1908, 1909, a seminal work from the beginning of the 20th century, If I'm not mistaken, Le Corbusier worked in his office for a short while, and so did Gropius, and I think maybe even Mies. You know, so Peter Behrens was indeed a very important modern architect who attracted the attention of younger architects who were trying to find their voice, so to speak. Okay. I mean, you know, we usually associate somehow Le Corbusier with Tadao Ando or Tadao Ando with Le Corbusier because they both didn't study architecture formally in a school. And we think that, well, Tadao Ando didn't work, as far as I know, for anyone, or he tried, but anyway, he didn't work for other people, or if he did for a very short time, but Le Corbusier did work for Peter Behrens. When he was very young. This is the work by Peter Behrens. It's an industrial building, but the honesty of exposing the structure, the honesty that Orthodox modernity was advocating is present in this work without being thus a so-called bored building or boring building. It still has the power to generate emotions, to provoke emotions. And it has a controlled expressionism, if I can say so. It's a good building. It's a good building by a very important architect who built other buildings also, not just this one, of course. Peter Behrens, moving forward, we still have some material to show. So even an industrial building can achieve the status of being called architecture if it is done properly. And when I say properly, is when it's capable somehow to generate, to touch your heart, if I am to use the language of Le Corbusier, since I mentioned him. Another building by Behrens, which unfortunately I didn't visit when I was in Berlin, but it's a building that can not easily leave one indifferent. I think it's very well built, and although again it's a building that is probably with an industrial function, or you know, it's still architecture, it's still interesting in terms of volumes of the articulation of the various parts, and it is architecture. I call it architecture. I don't know what it is now there, but we see these square windows kind of like in Aldo Rossi's architecture, but somehow the building by Peter Behrens is, I don't know, I am now on a risky ground. Maybe I should stop and not compare Aldo Rossi with Peter Behrens starting from those windows. I just want to show that, modernity was able to use different kinds of windows, not just the horizontal glass band as it was prescribed at one moment by someone about whom I just talked. Anyway, this is Peter Behrens in Berlin. Rob Krier. Now, Rob Krier, together with his brother Leon Krier, were very, very known at the time of postmodernism, not much afterwards. Rob Krier, also a sculptor, he built in the 80s, invited this IBA international effort to build housing complexes and all kinds of buildings related to housing. He built the sculpture is by him, but also he built the building that you look at. Postmodernism, in my opinion, was a failure, and it It irritates me actually with its rather facile, you know, nostalgia, borrowing from the past, rather formally, various elements. Maybe Rob Krier was not as affected viciously by postmodernism, but he was, but not so much like some other people, especially perhaps from the United States. Anyway, postmodernism, even Kengo Kuma, who is considered now very, very highly, I just read that Kengo Kuma was on the list of the 100 most influential people of the present, and he's the only architect there. He built an absolutely terrible building in the early 90s, I think, or late 80s in Japan. Just an unbelievable building, also affected by postmodernism, with a huge, you know, kind of a column, you know, classical column. You have to search for it. He himself recognized that he made some mistakes in the past. He did indeed. You know, I'm surprised Japan didn't remove his right for signature or his right to build after that building. Anyway, he did some better buildings later, it's true, but that one is, I don't know, was something, some kind of a blindness that came up upon architecture during the postmodern era. Anyway, we look now at the building by Rob Krier, and his brother is interesting and, he verbalized well about architecture. He was polemical. He didn't build, as far as I know, in Berlin, but Rob did. Now covered with ivy, I guess the building is almost acceptable. Any building covered by ivy is okay, really. That's why I keep telling the students, if your facade, your elevation doesn't work, just cover it with ivy and it will be fine. You can put the ivy wherever you feel like it, and you can make a very pleasant elevation from any elevation. Just allow the ivy to grow wherever you want it. Rob Krier again, but this time with a model rendering. And this is how the building was built. But he had the uniqueness in a way to also adorn certain parts of his buildings with sculptures. And sorry about the resolution of this. Now, brutalist architecture, we are approaching the end of this rather long excursion, or should I say incursion? No, probably excursion into the architecture of Berlin. It has examples of brutalist architecture that are not to be ignored. I personally like brutalism, and in the late, for the past several years, brutalismus came to the fore again. There was two or three years ago an important exhibition in Vienna, and they traveled, called the SOS, I think, Brutalismus. What we call brutalist architecture is an architecture which apparently could have traces of what we call what the word brutal means, but the emotivity, the sensibility even of the architects who were described as brutalists is not always and not necessarily brutal at all. The Free University. Now, this one is indeed like a fortress. It looks more like a Japanese building built in the heroic years of post-war Japan, which I admire actually. And but this is done in Berlin, Free University. I think it's an interesting building, you know. And yes, it seems to be rather, you know, defensive and misanthropic, but I think there is more to it. Now, this one, which I don't know how to pronounce, Beard Pinsel, this was colored, more recently. I don't know. I mean, you know, there are many kinds of architecture. This is one of them. Is it a brutalist building? I don't know. I'm not so sure about it. Anyway, depending on the colors, you know, the building is more assertive than at other times. But I still think it's a building that doesn't necessarily say no to what is called architecture. And you can see with various adornments, chromatic interventions, it almost looks differently all the time. It could be even joyous. So thus, is it really so-called brutal or brutalist? I wouldn't say so. Now, Berlin's incredibly cool and impressive brutalist architecture. These are not my words. I took them from the media on the web. Indeed, it does have several buildings. There is a website, Finding Berlin, where you can see examples of what is called brutalist architecture. The modernist architecture style, brutalism, is rising in popularity again, and Berlin has a few, well, I prepared this material about 3 or 4 years ago, but I still think what is called brutalism has a certain relevance and is still of interest, because when architecture became almost anemic, excessively white and minimalist, the brutalist architectonic gesture is sending us a wake-up call. And as such, I think is relevant. So, and Berlin has a few incredible buildings that still preserve the impressive and incredibly cool era of utopian aesthetics. Let Matthias take you on a tour through Berlin's brutalist heritage. I don't know who Matthias is. I'll just show some images from this site that I discovered. Not everything is actually so brutalist, but some a little more than others. I mean, come on, you know, any concrete wall is brutalist? I wouldn't say so, but I guess we became so comfortable with, you know, slickness and a certain kind of cozy minimalism that even, you know, a plain, concrete world seems to me to us to be so-called brutalist. I'm not so sure about it. Anyway, some are more than others, of course. This is the Free University, and I still think it's an interesting building. Some of these buildings were built in former East Berlin. And but here, you know, how could we call this building brutalist when we see clearly an attempt at ornamentation? We might not like the ornamentation, but the attempt is obvious. And it's leading what is here towards some kind of what I call architectonic or architectural embroidery, which is the very opposite of what brutalism is supposed to mean. But brutalism also is connected with what we might call heroism. It's a heroic architecture. And I think heroic state of mind, or a heroic, you know, positioning of oneself in life, is not was rather discouraged by high capitalism and the obsession with you know, consumption, and you know, entertainment, you know. Entertainment ruined you know, a genuine aspiration towards some kind of heroic stance in life. And I'm a great adversary of what is called entertainment, because I think entertainment became very frivolous, and it's enough to open any TV channel to understand how low entertainment became. For me, entertainment is about caressing a cat to death through the pleasure principle, of course. expressionist architecture. It has some great examples of expressionist architecture. Here is one of the greatest expressionist architects, Fritz Höger. This is a church from the 1930s. Too bad I do have more pictures. This taken from 2016. I think it's a great building, and I like Fritz Höger. His attempt at uniting the medieval with the modern, an attempt which is not easy to arrive at, actually. Fritz Höger, truly an important expressionist architect. Erich Mendelssohn also was an expressionist architect, but Fritz Höger also flirted, so to speak, with the Gothic sensibility. And I think this is quite obvious in this building, but this building is also modern. Again, I think trying to marry the modern with the Gothic is not easy. He succeeded. Here he is. He doesn't look very appetizing, so to speak, he was, I guess, an intense man, probably behind or beneath this rather leave me alone expression, was probably a very nice and kind spirit. It's possible. Anyway, the interior of this church by Fritz Höger. And look here, you know, modernism was supposed to be against ornamentation, was it not? But I think he, in a very subtle way and yet explicit way, is narrating the function of the building. It is a church, but the sign of the cross became part of an ornamental pattern. And there is some goldness also between some bricks. I hope I have some images. He was an interesting architect, expressionist, all right, but also I think subtle and even delicate at times. Look at this, you know, it's almost a touch of, look at this golden spaces between the bricks. You know, this shows subtlety and sensitivity. And there is something almost Byzantine here about this. You know, I'm thinking of Ravenna. I think it's a very good building by Fritz Höger. Another building by Fritz Höger, it's not a sacred building, far from it, but I think this one interesting as well. This is, I guess, some kind of a factory, yes, Berliner Fabrik, I don't know what that is. You know, even here, he allowed himself a certain level of ornamentation, which I think could add something to a building if it's done properly. Now, another building by Fritz Höger. Again, he's considered one of the important expressionist architects. Hans Pelzig, another architect associated with expressionism, the Babylon Cinema from 1929, kind of not very dissimilar from some works by Erich Mendelssohn, although Pelzig was a different architect. He also designed, made stage design for an important movie like Der Golem. They were interesting, these architects. They had social concerns. They had expressionistic concerns, some of them very exalted and exalting. They also, did other things, you know, like stage design in the case of Hans Pelzig. The interior is quite, if you make such a work today, you would be considered, I'm sure, very innovative, and your work would be published extensively and so on. Another important work, unfortunately, doesn't exist any longer. It was destroyed, and I think it survived the Second World War, but it didn't survive the the bulldozers of those who wanted something else. Too bad, the building existed before Hans Pelzig participated into the transformation of the building. The interior is famous for the history of architecture, and here it is. I understood that at one point this was all painted in red. So it's possible that Max Reinhardt was involved with this, if I'm not mistaken, as a director of theater and film. A remarkable building which does not exist any longer, and it's very, very sad. And this was a theater that welcomed all people, including less privileged or proletarians or whatever. Hans Pelzig, a building which does not exist, thanks to the Homo sapiens, who cannot abstain himself from destroying sometimes good works built by others, if not themselves. Look at the columns inside this Spielhaus that he transformed. This was also the work of Hans Pelzig, who said that columns need to be just inspired from old Greece. No, you can inspire yourself from other cultures prior to Greece, or directly from nature, as is probably preferable. Anyway, too bad that this building does not exist. Moving forward, look at the work of Homo sapiens. They destroyed a good piece of work. Maybe I shouldn't call it piece, because it's more than that, yes. Very sad, isn't it? So this building escaped the war, but it didn't escape the bulldozer of the so-called promoters of development. So in this unveiled, yes, in 2015, we unveiled a memorial for Max Reinhardt. Indeed, he was involved with that theater when Hans Pelzig did renovation of the building, or designed to represent the imaginary beam of a theater spotlight. The imposing monument can be seen outside the theater in Friedrichstrasse. Now, I think we are at the very end of the presentation. Brutalism meets the Baroque, a trio of churches. And this is also interesting, because the word brutalism describes something, the word Baroque describes something else. Both start with letter B, but they mean different things. How is it when they meet? Let's see. It's no coincidence that two mid-20th century churches located almost side by side in Berlin's Schönberg district look remarkably similar. Both were designed by Hermann Felling and Daniel Gogol. And here they are. Actually, Germany has a good number of very interesting mid-century built modern churches. Not very large, but in my opinion, worth being known and contemplated. It's possible that the national guilt deriving from the Second World War made them create very convincing works. And I really like the mid-century modern churches built in Germany, not just in Berlin. Now, if this is Baroque, I'm not so sure. If this is brutalist work, of that I'm not very sure either. But that was the language that I found on the web describing these churches. But you see here the old and the new, and they are in very close proximity. Why not? I think this is something that says yes to life, to a life moving forward and not backward. Now, NH Inhau Hotel, this is the kind of mainstream architecture that is to be seen everywhere now, with dramatic cantilevers. But maybe there isn't much more than that, just that dramatic cantilever. The Bauhaus archive, I have been there, and yeah, it's a good building, but the Kino International, this is a building from former East Berlin, and it is a building built, during the socialist and communist era of East Germany. I hope it will not be destroyed, because in itself represents something of a time which shouldn't be really forgotten, I think. Another building, well, these are buildings from the new governmental political center of the new Germany, the United Germany. And let's not forget, today, October 3rd, is the day, it's a national holiday, actually, in Germany, because it represented and it represents, since 1990, October 3rd, the unification of Germany, when the two Germanies came together, when no one expected it any longer, it happened. So this is an architecture that is democratic, moderately interesting architecturally. It's the new civic center in a way. Well, I don't know if I call it correctly. It's the political center of Berlin. How's their culture and their Welt? Is the house of the cultures of the world? I don't know. This building to me is a little bit too emphatic about its functions. It's a building that, in my opinion, architecturally, I don't know if it whispers the word culture or if it whispers the word stadium, or I don't know what. It's rhetorical, but I don't find great virtues in it. Now, an exhibition hall, we are really at the very end of the German Historical Museum by I.M. Pei. A typical IMP building. He's skillful. He was skillful at accommodating, a certain level of expressiveness in his modern architecture. I'm not so sure about all this extensive use of glass, which needs a lot of air conditioning. Otherwise, you'll melt in the summer because of the sunlight. But modernism without glass seemed to be, for many people, almost inconceivable. Then the International Congress Center, this was a huge building, I think, built in the 70s, a machinery for congresses, a large building with international ambitions. Yeah, the Chapel of Reconciliation, this is a small work. Minimalist in a way, and maybe with a touch of something else, considering that those curves are not explicitly based on a centralized geometric figure like a circle. But, and the velodrome, this might be the last picture of this presentation, with more than 400 pictures. The velodrome of Berlin. I don't know what to say. It is a velodrome indeed, and somehow I'm thinking of the stadium built by Albert Speer, which unfortunately I didn't show here. Maybe I should have. Anyway, this is a more recent work, a velodrome, and a velodrome indeed it is. That's it. So let's wish the Germans to enjoy their unification. And Antonia.